Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jan Fassbinder, and I'm the director of Paralimes, and I welcome you all to what I trust will be a very inspiring and exciting conference. Most in particular, I welcome Mr. Peter Ho, who is our guest of honor and who will open this conference. Peter has been a strong supporter of the Complexity program from its very beginning in 2011, and he was one of the first ones, if not the first, in the Singapore civil service to see the importance of looking at problems and challenges around us through the complexity lens. While still the head of the civil service, he gave the opening speech for the conference to celebrate the 80th birthday of John Holland, who in many ways can be seen as the father of complexity. Of complexity science, that is. Peter has been very persistent in looking for ways to introduce complexity thinking into the business of government. And although I'm familiar with the workings of only a small number of governments in the world, I dare say that Singapore is way ahead of all the others. In March 2014, the Complexity Program launched the Complexity Institute and then continued on as Paralimes. Very appropriately, Peter gave the keynote speech at that lounge. He was strongly supported the Complexity Institute from the beginning and has been closely involved in several of the activities the Institute and Paralimes have undertaken since. The conference that starts today is the first that is jointly organized by Paralimes and the Complexity Institute. And we are very honored and pleased that Peter has agreed to grace this event with an opening speech. Please welcome to the stage Mr. Peter Ho.
Thank you, Jan. And I am not entirely sure whether his description of my involvement in complexity is entirely deserved. I got into this business very reluctantly, and I realized that now it's my friend Professor Su Guaning is here. I should acknowledge his role in getting me involved in complexity and beginning to appreciate complexity, and it was because of him, and it was because of him that I spoke at John Holland's 80th anniversary conference in this very room in NTU. Anyway, you know, complexity is all over the place, so this particular conference, which is Complexities of Time, is a very curious topic, and when I was asked to speak at the conference, I didn't know what the topic was going to be, but I agreed, and then I found the topic was Complexities of Time, and realized what do I know about time, other than, you know, time's up, or, you know, you've got this time schedule to meet, and that's how we in government tend to think about time. But, you know, when I was preparing for this talk, which, by the way, I've only been given 15 minutes, so there's also a time limit for this talk, it's very clear to me that time is very much an abstract concept, and it also defies a very singular definition. So this morning, what I'll try to do is to take you through a random walk through different perspectives of time to show some of its complexity. So you see, I've got the word complexity, I've got the word time. So that's really going to be the approach I will take. So first, let's start off with time as a construct of the brain. The sense of time plays an essential role in many of the cognitive processes that shape our daily lives. Time perception, just like vision, is a construction of the brain. And just like vision, which can be distorted through optical illusions, our brain's perception of time can be distorted as well. For example, the brain constructs a coherent narrative by keeping a sensory window open for 80 milliseconds. Therefore, as long as a TV or film soundtrack is synchronized within 80 milliseconds of the movie track, you will not notice any lag. But if the delay gets any longer, the disjoint becomes apparent. If our perception of time is not as absolute as we believe, how can we ensure that our conclusions about reality are not affected by these perceptual biases? The author and neuroscientist David Eagleman wrote that our physical theories are mostly built on top of our filters for perceiving the world, and time may be the most stubborn filter of all to budge out of the way. Some neuroscientists are now beginning to consider conditions like schizophrenia and even dyslexia not as psychological or cognitive disorders, but as time disorders. For example, research shows that the internal clock in patients suffering from schizophrenia runs at an irregular speed. The hypothesis is that errors in temporal information processing could give rise to some of the symptoms of schizophrenia, such as hallucinations or the disconnect between thought and action. Second, time as a construct of speed. According to the World Economic Forum's Global Risks Report 2017, the fourth industrial revolution is creating new global risks and exacerbating existing risks. Klaus Schwab, the founder of the World Economic Forum, argues that the fourth industrial revolution is evolving at an exponential rather than a linear pace. His point is that speed, or more precisely acceleration, increases the challenge and complexity of these risks. Ray Kurzweil, the futurist and author of The Singularity Is Near, calls it the law of accelerating returns, explaining that we won't experience 100 years of progress in the 21st century. It will be more like 20,000 of years of progress. Charles Fine, an MIT professor of management, first applied the term clock speed to describe the faster pace of life in an industrial context. Then a new term emerged, risk clock speed, which is the rate at which the information necessary to understand and manage a risk becomes available. Artificial intelligence and the Internet of Things fall into the category of fast clock speed risks because there is insufficient time and information available to understand and manage the risks that they pose. Bill Gates, Elon Musk, and the late Stephen Hawking have famously warned of the dangers of AI. What new frameworks and competencies do governments need for effective risk management in a world of accelerating change and heightened risk clock speed? Fast clock speeds of the fourth industrial revolution give little time for government and society to adapt. Next, time as the arbiter of value. Nick Szabo, a computer scientist who designed a mechanism for decentralized digital currency called BitGold, which is a precursor to the Bitcoin architecture, argues that the ability to measure and verify clock time was a game changer for medieval Europe. The advent of the mechanical clock provided an authoritative measurement of time duration, which in turn led to the creation of time rate wage, resulting in serfdom and slavery giving way to worker choice and transforming in a fundamental way the economic institutions of the Middle Ages. E.P. Thompson, in his classic 1967 essay on time, work discipline, and industrial capitalism, wrote that with the Industrial Revolution, time is now currency. It is not past, but spent. Time as a basis of value runs deep within our social structures. However, time measures input rather than output. Clock time measures effort, not the result of one's efforts. While this made sense in the industrial age, where workers functioned as units of labor, in the wider machinery of production, the changing nature of work and the advent of task-based platforms are shifting the management and reward for work away from time, that is input, towards outcome, that is output. I suspect that this shift will prove to be a radical one and will lead to changes in many social institutions that are today based on time as a unit of value. Today, work and employment is still tied to time. While some companies have fully embraced work from home arrangements, the notion of working hours and taking vacation leave are still based on time-based notions of work. What will be the impact of greater gig-based work platforms and the disruption of time-based models of employment? The modern notion of time banking is also built on this basis of measured units of time as a common currency or unit of value. In time banking, the members of the community earn, collect, and spend time credits. Time banking builds on the notion of time as a unit of value that is collectively endorsed. In a climate of increasing inequality and decreasing trust in financial institutions, time banking promotes equality and the building of trust. When everyone starts out with 24 hours, and where 1 hour of a doctor's time is the same value as 1 hour of a blue-collar worker's time, there are fewer opportunities for inequality. In Singapore, two startups, Our Village and Kuidl, have launched time banking platforms. Could time return as an important arbiter of value that mitigates inequality? At the same time, the progress of science and technology can disrupt the value and importance of time. For example, scientists have now found a way to use ultrasound to age whiskey in days rather than in years. This overturns the time-based value of whiskey and changes time as the main arbiter of value, at least in the whiskey business. Next, time as power. The standardization of international time was both an important act of globalization as well as a parable of power. It provides a glimpse into the complexity of achieving greater interconnectivity in a world messy and fraught with geopolitical and cultural complexities. For example, in 1875, American railways recognized an astonishing 75 different local times, three of which were in Chicago alone. And before 1918, Russia was 13 days behind Western Europe because they used the Julian calendar instead of the Gregorian calendar. In 1884, the Prime Meridian Conference in Washington, D.C., agreed to adopt the Greenwich Mean Time system with 24 time zones centered on the Royal Observatory in Greenwich. The standardization of international time was arguably an exercise of global power by the British, who were then at the height of their imperium. Of course, this was not universally accepted. The French felt it was an indignity to set French time with reference to an English observatory. So in 1891, the French adopted a nationwide mean time and refused to adopt the Greenwich Meridian until 1911. Time as a cultural and linguistic construct. Different languages frame time differently. English and Swedish speakers tend to think of time in terms of distance. What a long day or a short break. Time is an expanse to be traversed. However, Greek and Spanish speakers tend to think of time in terms of volume, a full day. Time is a container to be filled. While we may speak about time in spatial terms, do we think about it in spatial terms as well? In 2015, researchers in Belgium scanned the brains of participants as they answered questions about the order of events that had recently happened or were about to happen. They found that these tasks engaged parts of the brain that supported spatial imagery. The reference to spatial concepts is our way of dealing with the abstract nature of time. As a linguistic and therefore cultural concept, time is intrinsically tied to our humanity. How does our language and culture bias or predetermine our view and understanding of time? Does this limit our concept of abstract concepts like time and space? Next, time as tool. Time perception is a powerful tool which can be used to influence decision making and behavior. The cognitive bias of hyperbolic discounting shows that humans tend to be more present-oriented than future-oriented, more inclined to choose a smaller sooner reward than a larger later reward. Yet the minority that resist the temptation of short-term gratification are rewarded later in life with better outcomes. The famous Stanford marshmallow experiment with young children showed that those who were willing to delay gratification, that is, wait to receive a second marshmallow, were rewarded with better outcomes later in life, like higher SAT scores, lower levels of substance abuse, lower likelihood of obesity, and better responses to stress. This suggests that shifting our perception of time to incorporate a greater future orientation holds the potential for better decision making, greater readiness for unpredictability in the future. At an organizational level, this is the role of foresight and futures thinking, to tell stories about the future in order to manipulate people into being open-minded. Pierre Weck, the founder of scenario planning, calls scenario planning the gentle art of reperceiving in order to achieve better collective outcomes 30, 40 years into the future. The Long Now Foundation is building a 10,000-year clock inside a mountain in West Texas, owned by Jeff Bezos, the founder of Amazon. The clock is literally a monumental attempt to shift our perception of time. Built to run for 10 millennia, with minimal maintenance and interruption, it provides a representation of how to think and talk about the future. If you have a clock ticking for 10,000 years, what kinds of generational scale questions and projects will it suggest? Why not attempt other projects that require future generations to finish? Are we being good ancestors? It behoves us to think about such questions. Time may be a complex concept, but it can stretch our perceptions and enable us to reevaluate our present actions by manipulating our ability to project into the future and imagine new possibilities. Thank you.